This is Johnnie Kallas on with ESPN Philly's Joe Staszak on 97.5 The Fanatic in Philly, Sunday, October 24th, 2020.
Excellent. I'd like to think, usually your Patriots are doing excellent, but I gotta ask, and I'll ask your dad about Eagle stuff, but since you're Mr. Patriots, what happened today? 33-6, Cam Newton throws three picks, they're now 2-4. What's going on up there in Foxborough?
Yeah, Joe, I'll just say, you and I talked back in mid-March when Tom Brady made the decision to go down to Tampa Bay. And we talked about how Tom Brady obviously wanted a change of scenery for a variety of reasons, but I think one of them was he just did not have the help around him. And I think that's what's going on in New England. Some people may look at this as Cam Newton not getting the job done. I've looked at it after watching this team for 6 weeks. They just have no skill players. It just reminds me of what happened last year. Amir Bird is the only person on the entire team who can get separation. They drafted two tight ends in the third and fourth round. They've done absolutely nothing. They have absolutely no help, and I think when teams are, putting eight guys in the box and they can't run the ball, they just have no ability to move the ball, and on top of that, the defense just isn't playing as well for a variety of reasons, so Cam definitely hasn't been good, especially the last 2 weeks, but I think you could, for example, put Jimmy Garoppolo on that team, and you'd have the same result today. They just can't move the ball on offense.
Well, that's unfortunate, but Cam Newton, three picks today. They haven't had a ton of offensive weapons when Brady was there, and I'm not saying Cam Newton was Brady, but it seemed to start out well this season, and then I forget who they lost to, but Cam Newton went for it on a running play, and they got stopped and lost that game, and then they haven't been quite the same ever since. So, they look good, now they look like not good, like Eagle-like. Like, what's really going on with the Cam Newton situation?
I think what happened is that Seattle game just misled everybody, myself included. Seattle, they went out, as you said, they came 1 yard from winning that game. They went for it on a fourth down.
Right.
It was fourth and goal, but there was no sack left from the one. And a play that had worked for them every time up to that point that year, Seattle covered up. Some people thought, they were being a little bit too predictable. They went for the bread and butter, and it just didn't work. Julian Edelman had, I think, the most career receiving yards he ever had in a game in that day. I would bet that 80% of his production came from that very game this year. He had, I think, two targets today, both of them resulted in interceptions. So obviously either Edelman has gotten old, which is a possibility, or Newton and Edelman just don't have the chemistry. And Joe, when you take away Edelman from New England's offense, who are you looking at? So, like I said, Demir Bird is... I can't believe I'm talking about Demir Bird. He's the only guy who has consistently gotten some level of separation from opposing defenders. And while their running game was extremely effective early on, I think they need to go back to some more RPO. For some reason, they haven't done that the last couple games. I don't know if that's Cam coming back from COVID. He's not, 23 years old anymore. You want to protect him for the long run. But that was the way they were moving the ball the first few weeks. They haven't done it at all. And I go back to that Seattle game. I think that said more about Seattle's defense, which, despite Russell Wilson being incredibly good, Seattle's defense has been pretty bad. I think that says more about Seattle's defense than anything. So New England has a tough time, and if their defense isn't playing at an excellent level, which they haven't been, they're going to be losing some more games this year, that's for sure.
Boy, that is rough because, all they have to do is look down south a little bit, and Tampa Bay is now rolling, and they're rolling today. Tom Brady has four touchdowns, no picks. They're up 45-20 over the Raiders. He obviously is still Brady, would you say?
Joe, Tampa Bay, I actually don't think, considering what they did today, this is too much of an out there statement. I think Tampa Bay has more potential than any team in the league, not just in the NFC, in the league, when they're playing at their highest level, because they do it on both sides of the ball. Defensively, you saw what they did against Aaron Rodgers, who, by the way, the Packers last year and this year seem to me to be a team that can really beat up on some not-so-good teams. If you play an elite defense like San Francisco last year, they got killed by them twice. And now Tampa Bay this year, we'll see if they meet again in the playoffs. They kind of slow down a little bit. So Tampa can do it on both sides of the ball. Brady is now getting going. He still hasn't developed total chemistry with Mike Evans yet, and they put up 40-something points today. So you have Godwin rolling. You have Mike Evans coming along. Antonio Brown, which to me, after watching today, seems like overkill. I think they were concerned that Evans and Godwin have been battling injuries, and if one of them goes down for an extended period of time, I still think they have enough weapons. We'll see how Antonio Brown gets mixed into that, because there seems to be too many guys to throw the ball to. But the Buccaneers, I think, based on what I've seen in a league that seems to can't play defense anymore, whether that's the rules, whether that's the quarterback play, whatever it might be, watch out for the Buccaneers, because they can go up and they can beat anybody in the league. And I think they're going to keep on rolling. They're playing really good.
Yeah, it looks that way, bro. And Tom Brady also has a rushing touchdown. They're 45-20 now. That actually is a final. Brother, great talking to you. Appreciate the insight on the Patriots. I'm sorry. I hope things get better for you up there in Foxborough. And we'll catch up with you soon, pal.
Appreciate it. Good luck with the Eagles, Joe. Talk to you soon.
Thanks, John. John Kallas. Great stuff.
This is, on the Comcast Business Hotline right now, my podcast partner, as I mentioned earlier on the previous segment, he is the great Steve Kallas. What's up, Steven?
Oh, good, Joe. Great to be with you, as always. How about them Cowboys?
How about them Cowboys? Well, let's talk about them real quick. I don't remember. I'm trying to think of another team. Forget about the NFC East, the team that's really just gone so far south and historically bad numbers defensively and players ripping the coaches. Now, the coach coming back at the players today for not protecting their quarterback, and now they're down to a third-string quarterback no one's ever heard of. They still have two wins in the NFC East, which is tied for most of the NFC East. What are your thoughts on what's going on in Big D?
Yeah, but I'm sure you're talking about the Eagle tie has put them in first.
Yes, I did.
When they did get the tie. Look, I thought Michael Crosby was going to be an improvement. I will say this, I'm certainly not going to defend him, but he's 100% right. You hit the quarterback like that, it's like hitting the goalie.
I agree. Right?
What happens in hockey when the goalie gets hit?
Oh, yeah.
He gets, like, rushed.
Uh-huh.
Exactly. So that was Bush League. I'm shocked at that. Now, maybe Tony's the backup quarterback, but Andy Dalton, you know, he's had a pretty good career. I don't know that you can expect him to be good in the big game, and he hasn't been particularly good, but to me, it's more about their defense. They got some weapons. We talked about their offensive line getting worse and worse the last few years, retirements, injury, and Elliott doesn't run as well, and Elliott fumbles on back-to-back carries the other day, and so they're a mess, but they're more of a mess defensively. I don't know how they're going to beat anybody. I mean, I think as sick as this sounds, I think the Eagles should be heavily favored to win the NFC East. Now they have Dallas, and then I think a bye, and then the Giants. They should have four wins. You're laughing at me. I know that's a lot of wins. They should have four wins after their next two games, but it's, to me, it's theirs to lose, and I understand that they've been decimated with injuries as well, but you know what? They got Carson Wentz, and nobody else does, even though he was hot and cold the other day, and I think fortunate as a team, frankly, to beat the Giants.
Yeah, very fortunate. I think the outlook and the landscape of the season turns dramatically if they lose that game and only have one win right now. Steams, I thought, look good, although against an awful Dallas team like we mentioned. I like a lot better than Dwayne Haskins, like I also said. Carson Wentz seems to make things difficult for himself, and then he comes back and looks like the hero. He does play with a lot of heart, but he still makes some mistakes from play to play at times that you wouldn't think a fifth-year guy would do. Is that him being himself, like trying to do too much, or mechanics being poor, like Marcus Hayes said, because he still overthrows guys or throws wide of guys sometimes when they're open. And then he can throw a pass like Boston Scott's, which was one of his highlight reel moments of his career. So how can you kind of like temper the good Carson versus the not so good Carson?
I just think in your fifth year in the league, your range of ability should not be that broad. It shouldn't be, I can throw a horrific interception running to my left and throw it anywhere near Bradbury, who's an excellent corner and the only pretty much good DB, certainly corner, that the Giants have, that one in the end zone where he was picked off. And plus there were two guys there as well, which strikes me as always stupid. Look, I think Carson Wentz can make incredible plays, and that's why I think they have the edge in the NFC East. And you have to try and limit, frankly, the bad throws, the bad mechanics, the stupid decisions, of which there are some. And 29 when you score that touchdown.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Take the extra point to get it into overtime. So the problem, if your decision is I'm going to be aggressive all the time, Riverboat Ron against the Giants of all teams, 20-19, you go for 2 to win the game. You're not going to beat them in overtime. You don't think your team is good enough to beat the Giants in overtime. So you go for 2, you lose the game. We were trying to be aggressive. We were trying to win the game. If you're always, always, always aggressive, if always you're going to do this, if always you're going to go for the first down, that's as stupid as always, always, always being conservative, where you're just going to, you know, run the ball and hope for the best and punt every time. It's the same thing, but on opposite ends of the spectrum. So it just strikes me as ridiculous. And the other things, of course, as we watched over the last 3 weeks, they had no plays for 4th-and-3 or 4th-and-2. They had no two-point conversion plays that work. I mean, teams used to have to then on, you know, the little have you guys flare out to the corner of the end zone right on the goal line, not a fade, right on the goal line. He can always beat the DB by a step. That used to be a tried and true two-point play. I don't know what's happened. I understand Philly Special was the greatest play in the history of the world. But you need some, you need 4 or 5, and I think you told me that Doug Peterson said they ran out of two.
Yeah, you did. And they ran out of plays.
Well, here's another newsflash. These have about 10.
Yeah.
You should never run. That's like Chinese restaurants running out of rice. I mean, come on. I saw tonight, Joe. It just came into my head.
Very nice.
I just don't understand. But getting back to Wentz, so what would you have to do now after you decide to go for it on 4th-and-goal from the 3? Not only do you not need a field goal, when they score the next touchdown, you need to score 2 touchdowns.
Mm-hmm.
You're down 11. Maybe you could tell me what field goal if you had to, and then a touchdown, a 2-point conversion, that's still 3 scores or 2 touchdowns. And thankfully, you got Wentz. You got Boston Scott, and now has to be officially the Giant Killer. No, he killed him last year. Right? And he killed him this year. That was a great throw, but that was a great route and a great catch at the biggest time of the game. So, again, the highest upside by far our quarterback is Carson Wentz in that division. There's nobody else. And you could have the Dak Carson Wentz debate, which would be an interesting one, but Dak's not walking through that door. Certainly, he looks like I guess he looks like a $30 million quarterback, but he turned down like 30 a year or 35 a year.
He wanted 35 a year over 4 years, and he wanted an extra $10 million, and they said no. He wanted 185, and they were willing to give 175, so he turned it down.
Wow, how stupid does that look now? Really bad. Although you see his value to Dallas now, I don't think they're giving him more.
No.
Maybe I'm wrong, but he's coming back from, he had ankle surgery or whatever, and he'll be coming back. And, yeah, you can go back 100% for that, but you're a year older, and that's any severe injury like that is a problem. I understand it's not an ACL. I get that. But, my goodness, this is the worst division in the history of football. And all these wins that are coming down might very well just be against each other.
Right. Which, again, 6 wins looks like it's going to do it for you, and that would be the worst record to win a division since, at least they've gone to this format, I think, since 1970 as well. It's incredible. But I think that's the way it's going, so we shall see. Real quick, before let's go, bro. I want to talk a little baseball. World Series, great game last night. Just unbelievable finish. Bill Buckner-esque, if you will, but the Rays with that small payroll tied with the Giants of baseball and the Dodgers 2-2. Your boy, my boy, goes tonight playing Kershaw. What did you think of Dave Roberts' reaction last night? Because Tolly brought it up.
Here's the problem. I did hear Tolly talking about it, and here's the problem for Dave Roberts, I think. First of all, you're the manager. You shouldn't show that kind of emotion. You're supposed to be above all that. But here's what I think he's thinking. If they don't win this World Series, I think there's a good chance Dave Roberts gets fired. And I think what he's thinking is, if they win that game, it's 3-1. The Rays ain't coming back from 3-1.
Right.
About Dave Roberts, that's what I'm thinking. I got this World Series. I'm not telling anybody that. Got to play one game at a time. But in my head, if I win that game, I'm up 3-1. I got Kershaw, and I think as low of you as Kershaw, as you do Kershaw in the postseason. You know, now that he's got the 12-12, just for the record, he pitched an 8-inning shutout, I think, 7 or 8 innings of shutout ball in the wild card round against the 29-31 team.
Mm-hmm.
That shouldn't even count. It should be like some rule. That shouldn't count if you pitch a playoff game in baseball where you're under 500. That's got to be like the worst records in the history of baseball. And don't forget the Astros were 29-31, and they almost made it to the World Series, which would have been an incredible disgrace.
Right.
But I think that's